Listening Library presents Parked by Danielle Svetcov. Read for you by Michael Crouch and Emma Galvin. For Charlotte and Josephine and their future wings. Noble deeds and hot baths are the best cures. Cassandra Mortmain, I Capture the Castle by Dodie Smith. You're just jealous because you don't have a friend who can fly. Fudgy, Super Fudge by Judy Blume. Departures. Chicago Public Library, Sulzer Branch. The following titles were renewed by Jeanne Ann Fellows and are due June 4th. Mrs. Frisbee and the Rats of Nim, Frankenstein, El Defo, Oliver Twist, Nooks and Crannies, The Lion, the Witch, and the Wardrobe, The Golden Compass, The Night Diary, Hatchet, Dr. Jekyll and Mr. Hyde, The Lottery, The Phantom Tollbooth, The War That Saved My Life, The Wolves of Willoughby Chase, Roll of Thunder, Hear My Cry, A Long Way from Chicago, One Crazy Summer, The BFG, Howl's Moving Castle, When You Reach Me, Pippi Longstocking, Swallows and Amazons, The Little Princess, Born Free, Ballet Shoes, The Penderwicks, The Saturdays, Brown Girl Dreaming, 101 Dalmatians, From the Mixed Up Files of Mrs. Basil E. Frankweiler, Mercy Suarez Changes Gears, Redwall, The Railway Children, Adventures of Huckleberry Finn, A Little History of the World, Zen and the Art of Motorcycle Maintenance, The Way Things Work, Finance for Dummies. May 8th. Jeanne Ann. I don't mind the nights. I stay at the library until it closes, which is 10 o'clock on weekdays, 8 on weekends. After, outside, it's mostly dark. I slouch on my bike seat and read by the light of the Food Mart sign next door. Tonight, it's Hatchet. I've read it a couple times. I like that one tool saves the kid's life in all these ways, and that his biggest threat is his weird mom, not the moose that charged him, or the bloodthirsty mosquitoes, or the tornado. I think about this as I wait. Someone on the library staff stays with me out front till mom shows. Mrs. Jablonski made it a rule. Mom usually arrives out of breath, running from the L. I swear the ground shakes as she gets near, like an earth-moving machine. Her shift at the restaurant technically ends at 9 on weekdays and 7 on weekends, but since her boss is a poisonous hydra in track pants who inherited the restaurant from his dad, mom oversees everything, including the other cooks, most of them hydras in training, who leave for the night without shutting the walk-in fridge or noticing the meat order for the next day never arrived. Mom is always running somewhere to fix everything for someone who doesn't appreciate it. So I can get to you, kid, she reminds me. We walk the same 12 blocks home every night. Mom carries my bike on her wide shoulders and sort of tilts over me like the teapot in the song. My book rides in the front pocket of my overalls. It's nice on spring nights like this. We can take our time. The air smells like burnt toast. It's warm. If either of us has breaking news, a guy cooking oatmeal on a camp stove in the library bathroom really happened. A customer at the restaurant stuffing an entire steak in her purse really happened. We share it. But usually we're quiet. That's because I feel like a squeezed out sponge after a day of sixth grade and just as many hours at the library. And mom feels way worse after a day at O'Hara's House of Fine Eats. It's nothing special, but I love this walk. If we stop on the way home, it's super fast and almost always to look in the window of the travel agency at the foot of our apartment building. The store there has been vacant since somebody invented the internet in 1990-something. Mom says, but no one ever took down the posters that are taped to the inside of the glass facing out. There's one of the Eiffel Tower, and one of the Taj Mahal, and one of the Golden Gate Bridge. They're all faded like everything else on this block. But Mom likes to tap the glass over the Golden Gate Bridge poster like she's got a plan. Which she does. I know she does. She just hasn't shared it with me yet.
June 1st. Cal. I can do this. I have to do this. Maybe I should have asked to do this. Just climb, I tell myself. The bricks are easy once I find the handholds. The wall is only about 6 feet high. I've studied it for 2 weeks after school. The tree growing out of the sidewalk on the street side boosts me past the 3 foot mark. Thank you, tree. The harder part is climbing with the paint cans. I need to get up and over quick to not be seen. But the cans in my backpack are like carrying another person. At the top, I know I'll have to jump. I pull myself up, look down, tug at the knot of my bow tie. I imagine the sound of bones breaking and then someone drawing the outline around my dead 12-year-old body. Then I hug the backpack, open my eyes, and leap. I wish I didn't have to do this alone. That thought slips in uninvited as I fall, air whooshing past me. Seaweed, sour milk, pine needles. What a San Francisco scratch and sniff would smell like if cities had scratch and sniffs. Then, thwomp! I'm on the ground and on my feet. It's not graceful, but I'm alive. Now the good part. I lay out my panels. The work will cover most of one wall, 5 feet wide by 6 feet high. I dig for my brushes and rollers at the bottom of the backpack. I have about 8 hours, the length of Mom's shift, if no one catches me. It won't be my best stuff. I don't have enough time, but it will be the most public. The four-panel pencil sketch I've put together tells me what I have to do and where, like a map. I've practiced all this in my head and on variously sized pieces of cardboard 100 times. I dip a brush into the green. If this were a school day, there'd be a roar of kids behind me, yelling, trading cards, candy, looking past me. But it's Sunday. The courtyard is still and quiet. I touch the brush to the bricks. They can't look past this.
June 1st. Jeanne Ann. Mom's beside me on the stoop, leaning over to peek at the note I'm transcribing for her. That's it. Read it out loud, she orders and closes her eyes. Please, she adds. I read, Dear Mr. O'Hara, I quit. The green beans with gorgonzola would have been great on the menu if you'd had the guts to let me make them. And the lamb croquettes. And the duck legs. You could have just called them specials of the day. People would have ordered. Good luck finding another cook with a brain in her head. You're a terrible boss. Joyce. What do you think? Mom says, opening her eyes again. I think duck legs and croquettes sound disgusting, but I've never tried them. Has Mom? I think everything is moving too fast. That we are playing in quicksand. She scoots toward me, so we're hip to hip. She's pulled a piece of paper from her back pocket. I sit up straighter. It used to be milky blue, this paper, 2 months ago when it arrived in the mail, but now it's turned kind of gray. She's read and refolded it so many times, it's got tears along all the creases. I've never read it, and I'm not sure if seeing it again makes me feel left out or just wound up. I lean in to see, but she tisks playfully and tucks it back in her pocket, like always. Fine. I don't know, I say, about the note she's asked me to help her write. It's not the sort of thing you can apologize for later. I take a deep breath. It's really final. Mom nods vigorously. Final is what she's after. I don't like the dear and Mr. parts, she says. Cross those out. They make it sound like I respect him. I cross out dear and mister.
What's Gorgonzola? I ask. Mom peers at me briefly, then grabs the note and crumples it. All the worry lines in her face have worked themselves out. You know what? She says, ignoring my question. He doesn't deserve an explanation. Come on. And that's it. She tugs me gently, but...
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.